This is the first talk, so we are still warming up. So therefore, appropriately, it is an introductory talk. Or rather, since I said I would give introductory talk, it has been put to the in the first slot. So either way, which is a good way to begin. So it's a mixed audience, some students as well as some experts. So with apologies to the expert, they would, I would go over some of the very, very basic stuff. So so filtering theory, it deals with estimation of signal that has been transmitted or sent over a noisy channel. And this also explains the terminology, signal, filter, noise, as opposed to error or estimation or so on, as is used in statistics. So the problem began with this, and therefore the terminology stays from a signal, filtering, noise, etc. Now, I'm going to be mainly talking about continuous time. So signal, noise, observations, all are in continuous time. That's what I'm going to be focusing on. But to introduce, it's easiest to talk about discrete time. So in my way of writing things, indices k, j, etc. refer in discrete as integers, and s and t refer to a continuous variable. So okay, so suppose signal xk is transmitted over a noisy channel. So at each time point, some signal is being transmitted. Xk is the thing at time k. And it's modulated via some transfer function so that actually h of xk is transmitted from your equipment. And it is observed in the presence of an additive noise, ek. So what is observed is yk, and that is given by h of xk plus ek. So very, very simple model. And deceptively, like when h is a linear function, it is deceptively close to what can be called linear models in statistics. But there is a difference, as I would outline. OK, so the interest is to estimate the signal at time k based on the observations y1, y2, yk. So it should be noted that the aim is not to estimate the distribution of the signal, as is usually the case in statistics problems, but to estimate the signal itself. And I must add that coming from a statistics background, when I first started reading about filtering, I was thoroughly confused myself as to what is happening. Because it started with assuming that all the distributions are known, and then I thought, then what are we doing? So the problem itself is very different. And those who are with engineering background, they don't find anything different here. But those, if any, from statistics background would find this different. So this is, to give a concrete example, something like voice transmitted over a noisy telephone line, or a television signal being transmitted over noisy airwaves. And at every time you want to get hold of what was the signal which was transmitted, decode it to the best of the abilities and move on. So at time k, we have observed y1, y2, yk, and we are interested in xk. We're not interested in going back and updating our things on x1, x2, etc., etc. We have just, at time k, we want to make a best guess of xk. OK. Now the conditional distribution, which I denote by pi sub k, of xk, conditional on the observations y1, y2, yk, is what is called the filter, in a loose sense. Somebody may call the mean, if this was a real value, somebody could call the mean of this as the filter. Somebody else could think something else. Okay. When we talk about conditional distribution, the advantage is that simultaneously we have got hold of best estimate of any function f of xk. So for f of xk, the estimate is going to be, or guess is going to be, integral of f d pi k. Now, it's common to assume that the noise is an IID in the discrete case. Noise EK is an IID sequence with Gaussian or normal distribution, which is same as normal distribution, and moreover independent of the signal. So that is the simplest case. You have IID noise independent of the signal. Now, what can we say about pi k? So if the signal has evolutionary properties, such as say signal being a Markov chain or Markov process, discrete times of Markov chain. So if this is so, then elementary calculations involving conditional expectations, Bayes formula and stuff like that, one can check that the conditional distribution pi k can be expressed as a function of pi k minus 1 and y k. Okay. All right. So what I meant was the following. The in statistical framework, often the distribution comes with a certain parameter. So we are not doing any parameter estimation. I should be a bit more careful here. We are not estimating any parameter. And a priori, we actually know the distribution. We want to fine-tune our estimate of the our understanding of the distribution by computing the conditional distribution. So the starting point, the distribution of xk is known. So if you may know that it's a Markov process with a certain initial condition. So you know the distribution. We are not estimating that. To estimate the signal or some function thereof, so simultaneously we compute the conditional distribution. So conditional distribution is not the same as the original distribution. So so it's a classic problem where you know a certain thing about in the Bayesian framework, you know the prior, and now you have made some observations and you are computing the posterior, right? So as your observations increase, your understanding or your knowledge about the phenomena is improving, and you are fine-tuning your estimate. So so what I said is still true. We are not trying to estimate the original distribution. We are trying to come as close to the actual value. But of course, in presence of error, we cannot get hold of the exact value. So, yeah. All right. So, so this is an important point which I stopped here so I can resume. So when the signal is something like a Markov process, then the conditional distribution can be obtained as a function of yk, our estimate at the previous time point, and just yk itself. This is important because when we move on to continuous time, this is what makes it feasible to derive a differential equation involving pi at t plus h in terms of pi at t and the observations over t to t plus h. Okay. Dependence on k would depend on whether you are your process is time homogeneous or not. So if the process is time homogeneous, then this also won't depend on k. Of course, my model here, I have taken this h function also not to depend on k. So if we bring in a h of k comma xk, then the updating rule will also depend on k. So if the h is not depending on k and the Markov process or Markov chain is time homogeneous, then the updating rule also won't depend on k. Well, in the limit, then pi k, if you have already reached the a singleton, then it won't be improved. But otherwise, at each step, it will keep improving. So even if pi k, he's right. Even if pi k is singleton, your process is not deterministic. Your process x k itself is evolving. So even if you know where you are at the previous endpoint, Yeah. Yeah, thanks. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so I think this problem with a deterministic system is not going to be useful, at least, I don't know. I have not thought about it, but okay. Okay. But is this so is it that the initial condition is non-deterministic then? Is that there or? Yeah. So in that case, if the evolution rule is deterministic, only the starting point is stochastic, then as time goes on, your pi k would keep coming closer and closer to the, I suppose. No? Even then, no? So if the signal and noise are Gaussian processes and the transfer function is linear, then the filter pi k is also Gaussian. In other words, the distribution is still Gaussian. And this is a very elementary fact from multivariate normal distribution or a Gaussian process, that you take conditional distribution of anything given a bunch of the others in the Gaussian system, the conditional distribution is always Gaussian. Moreover, any Gaussian distribution has two parameters, mean and variance. So the variance of the conditional distribution does not quite depend on the conditioning variable. It only the value of the conditioning variable. It only depends on the covariance structure of the given Gaussian process. This is a very important and interesting point, which is true only for Gaussian processes, as far as I know, may even be characterizing Gaussian processes. But No. That the conditional variance is deterministic. Conditional variance doesn't depend on the observation. Yeah. So Riccati equation, that it is deterministic. It depends on, yeah. If your system is Gaussian, then the implementation of this becomes very easy, because the evolution of the conditional variance is given by a deterministic equation depending only on the covariance structure, which can be pre-computed. And when the H is linear, there the this is what is known as the Kalman filter, and the equation for conditional variance is the Riccati equation. And therefore, In real time, all you need to do is to compute the conditional mean. And conditional mean and the conditional variance from the Riccati equation collectively gives you the entire distribution, and now you can estimate any function of this signal as you would like. So that is the this is what is the linear filtering, and known as Kalman filter, and has been used very widely in all kinds of instruments, and it has an analog in continuous time as well. Okay. So, main takeaway from this very small introduction in the discrete framework is that as to what is it that we are interested in. We are interested in estimating xk some function thereof, and the way to do it is to work with the conditional distribution. You see, the one question could be that, you know, why are we working with conditional distribution? Suppose we are interested in, say, estimating just f of xk for a fixed f. Okay. Why have we increased our problem by going to conditional distribution for all possible f of xk's? All right. The reason is that this property which I mentioned, that if the signal has evolutionary properties, then we can have an updating rule for the conditional distribution. But if you are carrying along only estimates of f of xk for a one function f, then we will not have this updating property. So if we are carrying along the entire condition, your best guess of the entire distribution, you get an updating property. If you carry along only f of xk, you will not get an updating property. In other words, in continuous time, you won't be able to derive a differential equation only for estimate of f of xk. So it leads to an infinite dimensional problem, not a one dimensional or even one dimensional. In some cases, it can be reduced to a suitable finite dimensional problem, but maybe you will hear about it in the afternoon. Okay, so I guess I wrote this slide yesterday on the flight, so there would be a few typos. Let us now turn to continuous time, and the signal is now a Markov process XT, and the observation model is, nothing has changed, I have just substituted K to T, which means now continuous time. Now, in analogy with discrete time, it is natural to require that the noise is again IID with Gaussian distribution and with some fixed variance. It is this object which is called the white noise. After the next slide. okay, go ahead. So I have not said anything that such a thing exists or something. Okay. Now the white noise as described above does not exist in the Kolmogorov framework of countably additive probability. Yeah. So. Yeah. So. The previous slide is not to be taken seriously. This is just to motivate to the next slide. Strictly speaking, such a thing exists, but that is not what is white noise, you're right. And non-measurability, even if measurability is solved, it will lead to infinite variances and we'll have all kinds of issues. Process existed in and is measurable so that we can talk about these integrals, then the fact that n was independent at every time instant would translate to w having independent increments. And if n were IID, w would become a stationary independent increment, and it has continuous paths by construction. So this would become a Brownian motion, and it would lead to a construction of Brownian motion with differentiable paths. So if you had that kind of process existing with measurable paths. No, this is all classical. This is nothing. Yeah, what do you take? All kinds of things go wrong here. Okay. So, however, one can construct such a white noise. Now, the such has been very loosely described, but by that I mean at something which is appropriate, which would correspond to the continuous analog of the discrete model that I had written. Okay, so such a white noise can be constructed on a finitely additive probability space if you move away from the Kolmogorov framework. And indeed, one can obtain results on the filter in that framework too. And this was initiated by Balakrishnan, and Kalyanpur and I worked on it for about a decade and had made various contributions in that. However, today's talk is not about the finitely additive framework. We are going to talk only about the standard approach in the Kolmogorov framework. So at tea time, if somebody wants to talk to me about this, I can talk about it. But so instead of looking at this heuristic model that we had, where little y sub t represented instantaneous observation at time t, and nt was the instantaneous noise at time t. Let us introduce capital Yt as the integral of y, which is now, it's like you have a certain, your measurement instrument is measuring something accumulated. It's like an electricity meter where you don't measure instantaneous power consumption, but power consumption up to a particular time. So it is integration over over time of whatever is this observation. So if you move to this framework, then we can integral h, this term gives you this, and integral of n, now n did not exist. We said if such an n existed, the integral would have been Brownian motion. Now you replace w. Okay, so this is the standard model now, which is we will talk about this model from now on, and this is the standard model in nonlinear filtering. So till now I didn't say what is x, what is what. So it could be in general we can take x to take values in some complete separable metric space, and this function h maps s into some k-dimensional Euclidean space, and then w is a k-dimensional Brownian motion, y is also a k-dimensional process which is observed. Okay, and all of them are defined on some probability space. Okay, so the conditional distribution of xt given the observations, this again L is superfluous typo. So the conditional distribution is some pi t of A is the conditional expectation. This is what is called the nonlinear filter. Now here I have said since I am assuming that S is a complete separable metric space, we can get a version of this conditional expectation so that it's a measure and all that. So I'm taking the regular version of this conditional expectation. The sigma field generated by, so sigma of something is simply sigma field generated by these observations. Okay, so the one of the early developments in the nonlinear filtering theory, coming close on the heels of Kalman filter, was what is called Kalyanpur-Strebel Bayes formula. And it's not a joint work with Bayes, but it's the formula is analog of the Bayes formula. That's why it's so if signal x and the noise w are independent, then assuming only that h is measurable, of course, that goes without saying, but beyond measurability, just assuming that integral of hxs ds, hxs square ds is finite, almost surely, one can verify that the measure p0 defined by with this object as the density. Okay. So there is an e power, this is minus, so if dimension is 1, it is minus h dw, integral h dw, and minus half h square ds. One can verify that this p0 is a probability measure which amounts to saying that this is integrable and its integral is 1. So when we define, use this as a Radon-Nikodym derivative, we will get the resultant object will be a probability measure. So p0 is a probability measure, and then under this new measure p0, the original y itself becomes a Brownian motion, and that is independent of x. And the law of x under p0 is same as law of x under p. So this is using Gersonov formula, or actually since we are independent framework, it's just Cameron-Martin formula for Radon-Nikodym derivative of translation of a Brownian motion, deterministic function, and Brownian motion itself. Yeah, I'm not going to talk about priorities. Okay, there are lots of names: Zakai, Duncan, Mortensen, Kushner, Stratenovich, So these things have been.
One question. So
Yeah, yeah. So in other words, I'm defining P0 like this. So let's define this function, okay? And now define dp, P0 is integral of that dp. Yeah. Oh, okay. Notationally, yeah, same P. Not because it is independent. Once you move away from independence of X and W, you get into, you need that some condition which will ensure that this object has integral 1, and that is Novikov condition or some other condition. So, but in the independent case, you do not, you get it for free. You don't need any condition. Okay? No, no, no. This is not the, this is not the Kalyan-Pusch-Striebel formula. This is a, okay. Yeah, yeah. No, this is Cameron-Martin formula. Cameron-Martin is written with one deterministic translation. Now you have randomized that translation. That's all. So this is exactly Cameron. That's why I've written it. It is straightforward to verify. So it's nothing but Cameron-Martin formula. Oops. Oh, looks like I have goofed up in writing. I think I've. No, I have written. So, okay. Now, one observation that. It may be noted that around this time, maybe late 60s, early 70s, the stochastic integration with respect to martingales was only just barely being developed and not yet in a final shape, whereas integration with respect to Brownian motion was well understood by the experts, not by a large group, but at least by experts. But even at that point, integration with respect to martingales was in the process of developing. It was not clear what is the right class of integrands, what is the right definition, et cetera, et cetera. So, saying that under this new measure, this is still a Brownian motion was important so that they can now still continue to do integration with respect to that object. Okay? This is just to put the thing in perspective. Okay. So coming back to the Kalyan-Pusch-Striebel formula, to precisely state it now, some more notation. So let me call omega 0 to be the path space of continuous functions with RK. F0 is the Borel sigma field. And Q be the Wiener measure on this space, and Y tilde I call the coordinate process on omega 0, and X tilde is a process on some other probability space which has the same law as that of X, our original X of interest. Okay, and now we look at this product space. So, so by construction, X and X tilde have the same law. By construction, y tilde is Brownian motion under p tilde, and y was a Brownian motion under p0, and xy independent, x tilde, y tilde independent. So the law of xy is same as the law of x tilde, y tilde. Now, so this f is also a measure, and this integral of that measure with respect to f is defined by this right-hand side. Okay. So this equation is defining a measure so and this QT is exactly the Cameron-Martin derivative which was there on the earlier slide. Yeah, so that's why the minus sign has disappeared. W has turned into Y, and therefore the minus sign adjustment has taken place. So for a minute, I thought, have I missed a minus sign? And just as I was thinking about it, you pointed out that this is the reciprocal of the Q appearing the earlier. Okay. So since so f is a measure and we write down h as the same measure which is normalized to integral being 1. And I have explicitly written it on a product space and so on, so that we have a explicit definition of we are integrating with respect to one variable, namely omega hat, and keeping omega 0 as it is. Okay. So you integrate with respect to one variable, omega hat, which was the omega hat came from the space of x. So we are integrating over that. On the state space of x, state space of x. So f and h both are measures on the state space of x, okay, and c sub b is bounded functions, and because we are writing the normalization, this h is a probability measure and f is a positive measure, okay, and the Kalyanpur-Strebel base formula is this. This conditional expectation of fxt given fyt is, I had defined this functional ht on this space. You plug in this observation y in that, and when I defined f and h, these were on auxiliary spaces and so on, and this omega 0 was just a canonical path in continuous function on RK. So this function ht is a functional which is defined on the path space C0 infinity, and you plug in y there in that, and what you get is the conditional expectation. So I have written this slightly different way than what is in the standard thing. One would just dismiss this in 2 lines, but then it is written itself in terms of another conditional expectation. So I have written it here in a framework where you have explicitly written it as this functional q as a function on the product space, and you are integrating with respect to one variable explicitly, and so on. So because there is a deceptive similarity to base formulas, which we get into when we do from prior to posterior, like the numerator is something and the denominator is just the normalizing factor for the numerator. So I don't know whether Kalyanpur himself called this base formula or subsequently others called it base formula, but maybe you might know. Okay. Yeah. So. Okay, so and therefore our pi t f is simply this functional h t which we explicitly defined, and you plug in your observation y in there. Okay, that gives you your conditional distribution. So in the independent case, you have a kind of a very relatively simple representation which is given by a construct a product space and integrate out one variable, and you get and. I may add that writing out base formula in this framework was very useful, because then various properties of continuity and various things follow very easily once we write the Kalyanpur-Strebel formula in the framework that I have written here. Okay. Of course, in this framework, we have not brought in anything about evolutionary nature of x, namely x being a Markov process, etc., etc., and then how can we update. So in any implementation of such a thing, this one of the important aspects of Kalman filter was the updating, that it was a differential equation, and that meant it was possible to do something in real time. So therefore, there was a need to look for something like that in continuous time as well. And so once again, who did what first is a difficult question to answer, but this is the framework in which you see different, lots of people worked on these areas, and there are slight differences in the framework in which they worked. So this work that I am now describing, Fujisaki, Kalyanpur and Kunita equation. So I'll be introducing the innovation here. Markov process, and so at this here, there is no explicit model of yt is equal to xt, h of xt plus noise. Okay, so in some other frameworks, they use this explicit model, and whereas this FKK work, it just assumes that x comma y is a Markov process, and A is the generator of the Markov process X. Now I'm using this term very loosely, but namely this MFT associated with X is a martingale for every F. And XW, it should be XW, not Y. Yeah, W is Brownian motion. So, but we are not assuming that X and W are independent. Okay, it's jointly Markov. Marginally X is Markov. Marginally Y is Brownian. But together, they may not be uncorrelated. They could be correlated. So that is expressed by that this martingale MF associated with X and the ith component of W, these two could be correlated, and this is their cross quadratic covariation, as it is called, is given by this. Okay. Cross quadratic variation is simply that process with bounded variation path such that product of these two minus this. So MFT WIT minus this quantity is a martingale. So the when we move away from independence, this is what we come out with, the cross quadratic variation, and that is the important point is that is given by a family of operators DI of F. So I should have perhaps used F takes value on the state space of X, but DI of F maps it to functions of two variables. So we are plugging in X and Y in the DI of F, you see. DI maps domain of A0 into bounded continuous functions on S cross RK. Then pi satisfies this equation called FKK equation, and so here the thing to note is that there is the first line would have been the standard Kolmogorov-Forward equation or Fokker-Planck equation for the evolution of the distribution. So the first line is exactly that, and then there are these perturbation terms. Okay, and the perturbation term here is a integration with respect to di, where I is defined as yit minus this. This is called the innovation process. So it's like, what is the new thing that you are learning in y? Whatever you could have estimated earlier and corrected for it, subtract that, and this is the new part which you are learning, and that's why the name innovation process. And in this generality, one can show that this itself is a Brownian motion, so that once again, in that time frame, they could happily talk about integration with respect to di. Okay. There were several, the innovation process had been talked about earlier, and one of the important conjectures was that the sigma field generated by this innovation process I is same as the sigma fields of the observation. And that was an important point needed in representing certain martingales which appear here. And one of the plus points or big points of this paper, as Kalyanpur told me, was that they managed to prove this without invoking the innovations conjecture. Okay. So, Yeah, so the once y is Brownian motion, every martingale adapted to it is a represented as a stochastic integral. But they managed to prove that in this generality, every I adapted martingale also has a representation. And a version of this equation is also known as Kushner-Stratonovich equation. So as I said, there are variations if you assume it's on, under some specific assumptions, maybe in RD or some differing assumptions, Kushner-Stratonovich also derived this. In fact, Kalyanpur told me another story about this, that Stratonovich derived a similar equation, and then somebody pointed out to Kalyanpur that look, something is the problem. Stratonovich is doing something similar, but his equation is different from yours. So there is a different term. And Kalyanpur said he tried to read it and couldn't quite resolve what is the difference. He talked to Ito, and it was Ito who went into both these things and figured out that what Stratonovich was doing was not Ito integral, and that was why of the birth of Stratonovich integral. Okay, so he was the different term was coming because Stratonovich was implicitly not doing the non-anticipating integral as in the Ito framework, but the midpoint or average of the at the two endpoints that is what is Stratonovich integral. So the if you now try to look at the authentic statements about Stratonovich integral and its connection to Ito integral are in Ito's papers. It is very important. Yeah, so Stratonovich integral is important because when you make go to manifolds or other geometric objects, it is the Stratonovich integral. In fact, so this Lie algebra, Lie group connections and so on and so forth, when you want to look at a Lie group valued Brownian motion and all that, the thing to consider is Stratonovich integral and not Ito integral. And in fact, at one point I had asked Professor Meyer that if that is so, then why are we still studying Ito integral? Why are we not looking at only Stratonovich integral? And Ito's, Meyer's answer was twofold. One, in things like filtering theory or in option pricing, etc., it is natural to have Ito integral. Therefore, anyway, one needs to study that. And second, because for Stratonovich integral, we cannot directly obtain any growth estimates. The best way to study Stratonovich integral is to study Ito integral and then have a connection between Ito integral and Stratonovich integral. Yeah, so. Yeah. But even if you are only interested in that space, you would still better off doing Ito and then making the connection between Stratonovich and Ito integral rather than just study Stratonovich integral. That's what Meyer told me. Okay, so let me come to more concrete. If X is RD value diffusion, then with this differential operator, and we assume that A is twice differentiable, B is once differentiable, and A is a strictly positive definite matrix. Then, I missed one slide, okay. So the Fujisaki FKK equation which I wrote had a non-linearity in F, and Zakai, working in a different framework, just looked at the numerator in the what can be called the Bayes formula equivalent, and obtained a very nice equation where there is the nonlinearity vanishes. And then the point is you solve this equation and then normalize the filter, normalize the resulting object sigma, and what you get is the filter. So the instead of going to the nonlinear equation as in FKK of Kushner-Stratonovich, it is much easier to deal with the Zakai equation because of this linearity. And when you have a so if signal and noise are independent, then the D term also vanishes, and you simply have a this is once again, the first part is what would be the equation for evolution of the distribution of the diffusion process itself, and this later part is a perturbation term. And moreover, if you have the initial distribution pi 0 admitting a density, then the law of xt itself admits a density, and this is the Kolmogorov equation or Fokker-Planck equation for evolution of the density. And the Zakai equation then is simply a potential term. Again, dy is missed from here, dyt. So the solution to this is sometimes called the unnormalized conditional density. Namely, you have some function which is integral is not 1, you make it divided by constant to make the integral 1, and you get the conditional density. So probably one should not use the word the unnormalized conditional density because it is not uniquely defined. But now, Y is missing here. So D capital Y is missing here. D capital Y is missing in that. So it's actually a first example of a stochastic PDE, SPDE. Okay. The Zakai equation is for the RD valued or Euclidean space variable is the first concrete example of stochastic PDE. In fact, filtering theory was the first playground for all the stochastic calculus development. The use of Grishinov or theorem or Novikov condition or even Cameron-Martin formula outside of development of stochastic calculus itself was in the context of filtering theory. All these Itô representation theorem. Now, while the equations for this filter described above were derived in the early 70s, the uniqueness of solution was known only for the case when H is bounded. Okay? So if you try to approximate a solution to this filtering equations, unless you know that it is a solution is unique and is the filter, you really don't know what you are approximating. So this had been a bottleneck. And I guess about 2 decades after these equations were derived, so somewhere in the mid-90s, Kalyanpur, Abhay Bhatt and myself, we used study of Markov processes via martingale problems and related results on uniqueness of solutions to the evolution equations, and concretely proved that the FKK or Zakai or Kushner-Stratonovich, all these equations have a unique solution, and that solution is the filter. So, no. Certain integrability conditions would be required, but very minimal. So, because the uniqueness proof was not via estimates, any proof via estimates requires polynomial growth or such things. So, martingale problem techniques and related results where there is a criteria for an invariant measure, then that leads to uniqueness of a solution to the evolution equation associated with the Markov process.
So this is viewed as a martingale problem.
Yes. And it uses Tom Kurtz's work on filtered martingale problem. Yeah. So So it's a theme of ideas where Kalyanpur, myself, Abhay Bhatt on one hand, Kurtz, Stockbridge and Okon on the other hand have contributed. This was the final culmination of that. So I'll just briefly describe that one can even go to a non-Markovian situation where the signal process itself, there is a feedback loop from the observation. Okay, in other words, in control theory, because you are applying a control, there would be a feedback loop into the signal itself in the way the signal is evolving. Okay? So, so x, there is a feedback loop from y. The script y is the entire path of observation path up to time t. Okay, so there is a feedback loop to the signal itself and the observation is there. And these are correlated noise, so there is the same DWT driving both of these. Appropriate dimensional space, and of course the CC star is identity, so that the noise here is still Brownian motion, but this is the explicit way of representing a correlated noise. And the only thing we assume is that this this SD admits a unique weak solution. So no other regularity or coefficients is required, only what is, whichever way you can prove that this equation has a unique weak solution, that suffices, and a certain integrability condition. No, there is no generator here. This L is law. There is no. I have not written down the generator. Okay. And now here is the generator for the X part, A tilde TF, and D tilde the explicit expressions for this from in terms of these coefficients. And then one can go back to the what I was earlier writing, applying FKK equation. This is a framework. So and for simplicity I am going to write pi s inner product with g for this quantity. So you have g is a function on time, then the observation space and the states. So integral of this dot with respect to the measure pi, I am going to write pi s g. And in this framework the FKK equation once again, so this is a non-Markovian situation with the feedback loop, and one can introduce the have the FKK equation. I is still the innovation process, and indeed the corresponding, if we write this multiplier, what we get is a linearized version, namely analog to the Zakai equation. And the nonlinearity is the feedback part, there is a dependence on capital Y, and the entire history of Y is there. So these operators are dependent on. So here is the nonlinear part, because this is for the ratio, and in fact, once again, mentioning Kalyanpur, he said that, in fact, the way they derived the FKK equation was deriving an equation for a numerator, then taking the ratios and so on. They didn't realize that the numerator equation itself should be emphasized more than the final conclusion. And that's what Zakai did, so. Or Zakai, Duncan, and Mortensen, so. So the... Okay, so what Abhay and I have shown is that for even in this framework with the feedback loop, the Zakai and FKK equations have a unique solution. Okay, I'll just take few minutes to finish with mentioning another interesting aspect, which is robustness of the filter. How does small variation in the model affect the filter? So we are assuming that we know the law of X or dynamics of X in terms. What if there is a small error there? How does it affect the filter? Or in, for that matter, a small variation in the function H. We think it is a given function, but in reality, it's slightly different. So do small variations here lead to dramatic differences or small differences in the output? That's the idea of robustness. And a priori, one should think that everything should work very easily. That should be so. But the question is deeper than what one thinks naively. Namely, make this observation. Look at this. Suppose un is all u, v are all real valued. Un goes to u and vn goes to v in law, or almost surely, doesn't matter. Okay. Can one conclude that the conditional expectation of un given vn goes to conditional expectation u given v? And the answer is no, and here is a very, very trivial and simple example. Take A to be a non-degenerate random variable. I've just said uniform 0, 1. And un to be identically A, and vn to be A divided by n. Okay. So the limit of un is A, limit of vn is 0. Now conditional expectation of un given vn is A itself, because you know the entire thing. You just take n times your conditioning variable and you have the original. So so this is A, while conditional expectation of u given v, v is 0. So this conditional expectation is the expectation. Yeah, so so something more than is required. But in the filtering framework, it is already there. It is there for free. That's what the point is. So so I'll write this double arrow to say convergence in law or convergence in distribution. And here is the thing. Suppose yn and xn are this at the nth stage and the limiting case. And let me write xi n to be this integral and xi to be this, which we require to be finite almost surely for our base formula to work. And let's define zn t to be these indefinite integrals.
Can you go back?
Yeah.
HN,
yeah, modular or transfer functions. Yeah. So hn's are also changing. And okay, yeah, xi should have an h, yeah. So all we require is that this triplet xn, zn, xi n, if it converges in law to xz, xi, and no other integrability condition, no derivatives, nothing, then the filter itself converges in law. And if all these are defined on the same probability space and this convergence is almost surely, then indeed, the filter at nth stage and the true filter, the difference is goes uniformly in t to 0. So, and where d is any metric which gives a topology of weak convergence. So the, I just talked about the various filtering equations and uniqueness question thereof, and then the robustness result.